What if I told you can use AI to create adaptive user experiences for moments that matter? That's what this episode is about at the Cozy AI Kitchen. When I think of product leaders in the world, there's one name that comes to mind. It is Wendy Johansson. Wendy Johansson, welcome to the Cozy AI Kitchen.
Thanks for having me, John.
Now, Wendy is someone who has traversed the fields of UX design, UX research, executive leadership. You may have seen her on television, et cetera, but she represents the full gamut of tech leadership. And most recently at Amazon, she created a whole new program. And now she is co-founder and chief product experience officer of your own startup. So what does your startup do, Wendy?
Yeah, my startup is called Mi Salud Health, which means my health in Spanish. And we are here to close the health equity gap for all the Spanish speakers in the United States. You know, it's 25% of the population continues to grow and just a continued underserved population where, you know, so many comorbidities keep happening to them, you know, diabetes, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, all of these kind of silent killers that kind of live unmanaged within a population because the U.S. healthcare system is just so complex and not friendly, even for myself. I'm just still getting random $2,000 bills because I went to see my doctor who recommended I get an ultrasound. And then I thought I had good insurance, and then I'm just getting all these crazy bills, and I don't even understand how to navigate, make sure I'm in network. And I can't imagine trying to do that when you have so many other pressures in life and English is not your native language.
And I know that you are fluent in Spanish, so we're going to go there. Wendy is like super international stuff, so just don't talk about Europe yet with her, but she covers the whole thing. Okay, so Wendy, this is one of the early semantic kernel tools. We have a toaster, we have a rice cooker, but I want to show you our brand new, oh my gosh, so excited about it, our brand new space-age microwave oven that powers AI agents. Let me show you. Here we go.
Wow.
AI, ta-da! The AI agents are this element of computation. Oh my gosh, we all love it, right? But that's like tech stuff. And I know that you're a tech person and you are in the space of problems. And I'm sure you've noticed because you have a cool engineering team that I know you speak so lovingly about. The engineering team is writing native code. And because of native code powering apps, they're now told to use AI. And AI is made out of dice, like non-deterministic, right? Like, how do I combine those two together? So at this juncture, agents are a kind of computation that enable people to write code with job descriptions, right? So I know you described a problem about phase one limbo. Can you talk about that?
Absolutely. So we deal with a lot of patients with chronic conditions like hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol. And we have what we call a chronic conditions program for that. It's a couple of weeks long, depending on the severity of your condition. And, you know, it seems pretty straightforward. You come, for example, for 6 weeks to improve and better understand your diabetes and how to manage it. But life happens, you know, people don't have that kind of time and dedication right up front to come in week over week and say, hey, I'm going to measure my glucose. I'm going to stop drinking sodas at my break. I'm going to start getting a little more movement in my life. It's not going to happen between week one and two. Creating habits takes time. And we see a lot of people become discouraged and drop out. And that's kind of their phase one limbo, phase one of trying to get to a healthier, better life. But you already failed week one. You didn't do your homework. So why come back? And there's a lot of that needs to happen for our clinicians to continue to adapt and every week see, are we really into week two of the program yet? Or are you still in week one mentality because you didn't really have the time and effort to, you know, do these changes? So how and when do we know to move you to actual week two programming? And how do we encourage you to not drop out of that journey?
And when you describe this problem as a user experience problem that's largely unsolved, I went to the AI kitchen to try to solve it. So let's show you what I cooked up and you can tell me how it might taste. Okay, so let's see here. So this is a quote by Wendy about being in a supermarket, doing user research, asking people to sign up, and your point about the kind of questions you ask, they're kind of concerned about them, correct?
Absolutely. Folks were talking about, for example, not having an ID. And for me, I was thinking, like, does that mean you don't have a driver's license? Like, what exactly does that mean? And we realized that they were kind of intimating that they were undocumented. And, you know, could we actually help them? And where would their personal information go after that?
And really, now we're going to go into the AI kitchen. Gets very technical, which I know you are fully comfortable with. But we're bringing some packages over. We're getting our OpenAI, Azure OpenAI set up. And I want to do a little warm-up exercise for the true nerd cooks out there. Because as we know, the problem, Wendy, with native code is it is structured, but semantic code is unstructured. And so a common problem is how do I do things in semantic world and bring them back into native code? We use JSON. And the model is getting better and better at going from semantic world, just text, to actual JSON. And this is an example of a more advanced JSON example for those JSONers out there. Basically, creating an entirely well-formed JSON. Again, going back and forth is important. Native code and semantic code. But that can sound kind of boring. So let's go ahead and cook with agents, because we have our fancy space age microwave oven. What I'm doing here is I'm setting up the agent. And do you use agents in your startup at all, Wendy, yet? Is that something you do?
We use real human agents, and they are assisted by kind of various, I would say, efficiencies. However, they're not fully standalone agents today.
What we're doing is we're bringing over the agent packages. They've arrived, semantic kernel experimental agents. And we're going to get an agent-y with a lesson planner. So, you know, Wendy, you're asking, how does the AI build an adaptive lesson plan? So I took that to heart, and I created an agent whose job is to express the different phases of learning to the user. And based on a given week and activities performed, they advance them to the next unit. But when the user doesn't complete the task in the assigned week, they will get frustrated. So we want to, like, accommodate them. So this agent is an accommodating lesson planner that will rewrite the lesson plan. Okay, so let's go and hatch that agent. Here we go. That agent, lesson planner is ready now. And this lesson planner has a job description. Good. And next up, we're going to make a lesson plan. And the lesson plan reads like this. Your lesson plan has 3 weeks, why health matters, what the health data is for, and how do these recommendations. So I'm going to add that lesson plan in. And the agent is going to then get hatched. Good. Okay, now we're going to add a thread, something called a thread. And then now we're going to have the lesson planner kind of reiterate what that lesson plan is about. This is all very exciting, Wendy. This is what's happening. The agent is in the house. Do you feel the excitement? Maybe?
I think it's super exciting. It really helps people have more of a personalized custom health journey and not feel like, you know, I missed my homework last week because life happened. So if we're able to adapt and those agents are able to kind of adapt that lesson plan to where they are, it makes people feel more empowered. Like, oh, I didn't miss a week. Like, life happened and it's okay and you're encouraging me. And I think that's really important.
Spoken like a customer-centric product leader. Okay, so here we have it. The agent, the lesson planner agent, is basically responding back with the plan, okay, their interpretation, okay. And now we're going to add voice. Here we go. This is a little dangerous, but we're all using ChatGPT mobile. It's kind of cool, so why not add a little mobile? So here we go. Okay, let me see if this works. Hello, I'm talking with Wendy. Ho, 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 it worked. Okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to pretend I'm the user, and I'm going to say, it's week one, and I haven't measured anything yet. Okay. And now I'm going to like pass it on to the agent, the lesson planner. And it's going to, and this is where like I want to get to that frustration point where I'm too busy, Wendy, where I couldn't do the work. It is 2024 and, you know, this is a microwave takes a little time. You know, we were setting it on 50%, you know, that's the right way to cook.
How much time did you set this microwave to?
It took a while to create the microwave, you know, so, you know, this is that one of those like anticipation making me wait moments. Maybe that's trademarked, but anyways. Okay. All right. It's thinking. And so what it's doing is it's taking the user state, and ooh, as you're in week one and haven't begun measuring your health, let's focus on helping you start this process. And so it's really trying to get you going, okay?
Yeah.
And then now I want to have a moment where like, it's week two and I couldn't do anything for week one. Okay, now let's see what the agent says back. The lesson planner has been told, even if that happens, enable the user to feel like they're getting it done.
Yeah.
And again, this is all written in semantic code. So there's no actual, like, you know, regular brittle sort of native code being done. And it's amazing what you can cook.
All of these ingredients help encourage somebody, just like, you know, any weight loss plan or gym plan. You feel like you missed that day or you cheated a little too much that week, people give up. So let's see what the agent can do to encourage them and keep them going.
And this phase one limbo is traumatic, I imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Since it's week two and week one's activities are not completed, it's important to address. So it's trying to kind of like remind you it's pending, but it wants to move you to week two. Now, let's say in your app, Wendy, you wanted to use this. The way you would use it is I would then take this information and have it generate a JSON array that you can display in your app, like that. So it's able to expand, contract, move to native code. Okay, we finished cooking, but I would prefer to talk about the taste. So, Wendy, can you describe your experiences in the shopping market for a second for the listeners out here?
Yeah. So we went into a Hispanic grocery store down in San Jose, California, largely a Latinx neighborhood. And we set up a booth in the front where we basically had a banner that said, Mi Salud, My Health. Our slogan in English would be health in your hands, because you're able to get it from your cell phone and, you know, talk to a doctor either by phone or by video. And so many people were, first off, just in awe of, like, wait, this is in Spanish? Like, you know, me and my colleagues who are obviously Latinas and Latinos, and they were just coming up to saying, like, wait, so I can talk to somebody in Spanish, and this isn't just somebody who is Google translating to me or, you know, having an interpreter in the middle. And they started telling us about, like, well, you know, I've been feeling these things and I've never been able to get help, or it just seems so expensive. I wait for my, you know, annual trip back to see my family in Mexico, Venezuela, whatever, and go to the doctor then. And I think it's just being able to get empowered and see that there's something out there for you, being served by people like you who understand not only you, but your diet. One of the things I remember hearing from somebody was, you know, I did go to a doctor. She told me I need to lose weight to feel better about, you know, all these things happening to me. And she told me just eat less carbs. And she's like, I don't even know what a carb is. Is that my tortilla? Is it the frijoles? Like, what am I supposed to do? And so, for example, with Mi Salud, we're able to give them a health and nutrition plan specific to their diet from whatever country they're in, and give you the recipes and tell you, you know, here are healthy things to cook. And today, I think the fun end side of that is we're often hungry at work because our patients keep texting us photos of their healthy meals because they're so proud of it. So we keep getting all these texts of beautiful food plates, and, you know, it's the middle of the day and we're saying, like, wow, that looks great. How do we get some of that?
You know, Wendy, listening to you gives me warm feelings. The Cozy AI Kitchen is about coziness. I know your story about how you would actually go to people's houses and see on the fridge instructions by people's children. for their mom or dad. And as someone who understands caregiving, we understand that as well. Thank you so much for bringing this cozy AI insight to the kitchen. Wendy, any sort of parting thoughts for the audience who's thinking about the world of startups and medical world?
Absolutely. In the world of startups, technology, it always starts with the people. Whether you're building AI, whether you know you're just building a mobile app, I think understanding the core of the people, how they live, go out, see them. And until you experience and meet your users in person, you're going to just be building for an idea rather than a real person.
All right. Well, thanks for coming to the kitchen, Wendy.
Thanks so much, John.
All right. And more episodes soon. Stay tuned.